is a $300 custom chassis worth the money? What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another new video. This time here, we've got a custom build that I've just finished putting together. This chassis is made by a company called RC Speedy. And what you see here in front of you is a custom TIG welded chassis that's made to work with the Axial Capra base. I purchased this chassis from RC Speedy and then I built this custom Capra based crawler underneath of it. Today, we're gonna go through all of the details on what you see here in front of you and my thoughts on whether or not buying a chassis like this is worth it. First, I'm gonna give you just some of the general facts on this RC Speedy chassis. This is the R1 chassis, it's called, and it's based after a full-size moon buggy. If you're not familiar with the term moon buggy, it doesn't actually refer to vehicles going to the moon. It refers to competition-based full-size rock crawlers, and those have been called moon buggies for many years. And then that name has just trickled down into the RC area. But this is the R1 design. It is stainless steel tubing for the most part, and then it's TIG welded. Now, it's actually what looks like cold TIG welded, which is a little bit different than standard TIG welding you may be used to. It's got a different look. You can see that it's got the, you know, stacked dime look as far as the welds go. It's just done in a different process. It's almost like kind of tack welding over and over and over. But that looks like what has been used here. Now, the other thing is that, like I said, it's said to be stainless steel tubing, and you can tell that it's tubing in a couple of areas. The bottom side of these front hood bars go down and terminate, and there you can actually see the tubing portion. However, if I grab some of my rare earth magnets, you can kind of feel that it doesn't stick to the tubing as you'd expect, except in some of the smaller areas where they actually will stick. So I'm not sure if it's just maybe a really low grade stainless for some of these more solid pieces or what, but it doesn't appear that it's all the same material or necessarily all stainless. The overall style of the chassis is going to be a personal preference thing, but I do like moon buggy style. So I like the look of this chassis on its own, and the welds look very good. Cold TIG welding may not be as strong as typical TIG welding that you're more used to, but it looks good. And if you're gonna leave the chassis raw like this, it really does have an impressive look. I also opted for the optional aluminum body panels. These cost you an extra $35, but they're laser cut, all the holes are pre-done. And as far as the fit and finish of the body panels onto the chassis, it's pretty nice. Now, the fit of the rest of the chassis we'll get to in a little bit, but first I wanna go through the rest of the parts that I use to complete this build. All of the products that I'm gonna talk about in this video, I'm going to link in the description below or in a link to my website where you can go and find all of the details about this truck. So you can follow that and find exactly what I'm using if you have questions. Starting off in the chassis area, I decided to go with an aftermarket skid plate because I didn't want to use the stock Axial Capra transmission. Not a big fan of that transmission. The gearing is not low enough at all and it causes a ton of problems with the Capra that I'm just not a fan of. So I chose to go with a UC Fab skid plate, which is a machined Delrin skid plate with carbon fiber side link mounting plates. Now, that skid plate is machined to work with standard axial three gear style transmissions. So along with that skid plate, I decided to install the Vanquish three gear transmission kit. This is a complete kit, aluminum machined motor plate, transmission housing, all steel machined gears inside, slipper eliminator, the actual spur gear, everything in one complete package. An easy part you can pick up, you have a fully built transmission you can drop right in. Then as we move further out, in the front I went with a Vanquish Curry Capra axle housing. Now this is different than the stock housing as it does have an offset pumpkin. Now the pumpkin is that center section where your ring and pinion gear go. It's offset compared to the centered version of the stock one. This is for scale styling. It looks more realistic and in general also gives you a little bit better clearance. Now, since that's offset, you can't use the factory axle shafts. So this housing comes with those axle shafts and it comes with new steering links for the front as well to improve the clearance for a little bit more steering angle. The rear axle housing is also a Vanquish, also for the Capra. It's got a centered rear pumpkin still, but this also does have adjustable upper link mounts in the rear, so you can raise or lower those link mounts to adjust your anti-squat in the vehicle. This can improve your climbing ability. You can kind of find the sweet spot. How or where you set your anti-squat is dependent on the center of gravity and the ride height of your vehicle, so it's not a one-stop solution for everyone. A fixed link position isn't always necessarily the best. This just gives you some adjustment to play around and see what might work for your setup best. Now, since I didn't really start with a capper in the first place, or not very many parts of one anyway, I grabbed a Fast Eddy bearing capper bearing set and I used that to complete, you know, all of the odds and ends bearings that I was going to need for this build. The inside of the axles, in the front, like we discussed, it comes with those front axle shafts, but inside I used a Vanquish machined AR44 ring and pinion set, as well as a Vanquish spool. In the portal boxes, I used the Vanquish Overdrive Capra portal gears and Vanquish Capra lower stub shafts. In the rear axle housing, I used the Vanquish axle shafts again in the upper and the lower portion. The upper axle shafts also include an additional bearing so that you have a more well-supported shaft in through there. The Vanquish axle housings are machined to make sure that those are accepted. Not all of the axial housings will accept that additional bearing, but with combination of those axle shafts and the Vanquish housings, you can get that and add some better support to your outer portal gears. All of the axle shafts that are used in this are machined in the US out of chromoly steel, just for the best strength that you're going to be able to fit into these housings. In the rear, I also used the same Vanquish AR44 gear set. After I actually built this, we released an underdrive gear set that we could have dropped into that rear axle for a little bit more overdrive percentage, but I didn't end up doing that at the time. I just built it with the stock style ratio. Now, in the rear portal boxes, I used the Vanquish standard ratio portal gears. So overall, I'm gonna be around like an 18 or 20% overdrive in this vehicle. Nothing over the top, but if I wanted to increase it a little bit, I could throw that rear underdrive gear set in and get me a little bit closer to that 30% range. To complete the axles, I did use some Hot Racing brass front knuckles. This will give me just a little bit more forward bias. I didn't add any weight to the wheels themselves or anywhere else on the vehicle, so that was the only area that I added a little bit more front bias. Connecting the axles to that transmission, I've used a set of Incision drive shafts, and the link set that I used on here is the only stock part left from my original axial Capra. To set the ride height on this, I installed Incision 90 millimeter shocks all the way around. These are about 10 millimeters shorter than a factory Capra shock. But as you can see, I feel like the ride height on this is still higher than I'd like. And I think that's partially due to the design of the chassis. I wish that if you're gonna go with a full new custom chassis design, should have raised the shock mounts even a little bit further. I could go to an 80 millimeter shock to help get things just even a little bit further down. And I think that if I continue with this build, that will be the route I go, just to try and get this thing a little bit lower, because right now it's just sitting far too high. The Incision shocks are riding on the Incision brass shock pivots in those upper shock mounts. And then moving on to the rolling stock. For wheels and tires, the tires are Pitbull Braven Berserkers. These are 2.2s, but they're only 5.12 inches tall. So they're a really short 2.2, which I really like the look of. I think it just gave it a little bit more tire, but without going full 2.2. The wheels that I'm using are custom Cerakoted, but they're the KMC 2.2 Machete. I had them Cerakoted in white, and then I've got a gray beadlock ring on there, and then built with black wheel hardware. For electronics currently in here, we've got a Holmes Hobby 2700 KV Polar Pro V2, and the servo is an NSDRC RS800. I plan to use a Castle Mamba X ESC, which I do have, but I don't have installed, and we'll get to that reasoning here in just a minute. For the ESC, I'm going to be using a Castle Mamba X ESC, but I don't have it installed into the chassis, and that kind of brings us to some of the issues. I think that the style of this chassis is good. I like the style overall. The welds look good, and as far as I can tell, I think that they're going to be strong enough that there isn't any concerns there. But I do feel that it sits way too high, and even with a 90 millimeter shock already, it just doesn't get down to where it needs to. And I won't run droop. I don't like running droop. It's not a setup that I think is the best for performance, definitely for me, but in general, I just don't like, especially if you use any wheel speed, when you're trying to climb up something and you hit the rear axle just with even a little bit of momentum, there's no up travel. So you end up unsettling the car by bucking the rear up. Just again, not something I like, and I always run sprung suspension. But the bigger issue beyond the ride height itself or anything like that is these front shock mounts, the angle of them specifically. Now I'm using a stock link set and the axles use stock mounting positions, but what happens is that even with these short shocks, I can't get much more than maybe half travel before they almost completely bind up. I cannot get the vehicle to push down further than that. Articulation doesn't get much further in the shock travel either. And what's happening is that these shock mounts are straight up and down, but the shock has to go at an angle. So it's binding up against the cap of the shock and therefore putting a big bending force on the entire assembly. Unless those tabs are completely repositioned to work, I'm just not going to be able to make it function. The only option that I might have is to take the shock and move it onto the front of the mount, but I'm losing the double shear mounting. It's not going to look proper in general, and it's just not right. There is a possibility that with a longer shock or a shock of much narrower design that maybe it wouldn't bind up, but seeing how bad this is binding up and at the travel that it is already, I don't see that that's going to be the case. Now, I did email RC Speedy about this, and they did offer a refund if I sent the chassis back to Hong Kong, but that doesn't really fix the actual issue of me wanting to do a custom build around it. So my real only option, I think, is either to move the shocks to the outside, run a spacer between them and just deal with the looks, or cut the tabs off and then weld on my own. Now, some of the other issues I've got currently with the build are not issues caused by RC Speedy. It's caused more by just building a custom truck with an assembly of different aftermarket parts. The big one is this UC Fab skid plate with the carbon fiber link mounts. They kind of come up a little bit higher and they interfere with this battery tray in the front, but not too badly. However, the electronics tray in the rear, they interfere with quite a bit, to the point that it's kind of hard to get everything forced up in there. And my drive shaft actually interferes with it as well, also kind of limiting my travel. So the rear electronics tray, I'm actually, I think, going to just cut out, remove completely from the chassis. And then there's a couple of other mounting points in the chassis that I can use to then make my own. So I think that one is going to be an easy fix. The front, the links themselves are not binding up. It was just, I had to push it up in there a little bit because it's right in contact with that tray. Not something that's actually an issue. But back to the main question, is buying this chassis worth it? Now, if you've never built with a full custom fabricated chassis, like a tube chassis, issues like this can pop up. It's not necessarily that uncommon. More specifically, things like this electronics tray and the battery tray, where you're just gonna have some interferences using different aftermarket parts and trying to make them all fit. But the shock mounts, those are a much bigger issue and something that doesn't necessarily have just this easy fix of something to make it work. To make this truck work, we're gonna have to do some things that are far from ideal to really make it functional. Now, hopefully RC Speedy has either adjusted these mounts for future trucks or will adjust them here in the future. So is $300 for a chassis worth it? Yes. In most cases, I think that a nice custom built chassis, $300 is a bargain. But unless RC Speedy specifically notes that they have fixed the shock angle issue with this chassis, I would not recommend buying it. However, that should be a very easy fix, and hopefully they do that in the future. But at the same time, I feel like this truck still rides too tall. So is it worth spending the money to have something that maybe still doesn't look quite right? The real question is whether or not you guys think that spending that kind of money on a chassis is worth it. I spent $299 on the chassis itself, $35 on the panel option, and then an additional $50 for shipping. So total bill on a chassis like this is not cheap, but custom tube frame chassis are rarely cheap, especially if they're done well. So I want to hear what you guys think. Does that price tag, equal out to what you get in the end. Are you guys interested in it? Assuming that they can fix the front shock towers, do you think that this is something that you would like to buy? After I finish cutting out the electronics tray and modifying things to work properly with all of the parts that I've assembled here, I'm hoping to get this thing out on the rocks. Hopefully I can find a solution to these front shock towers that in the end make this truck function properly. And also probably swap over to some 80 millimeter shocks just to help get that ride height around where I'm looking to have it. So drop what you think in the comments down below. Love to hear what you guys think about this type of truck. Capras are a little bit different mix. Not everybody likes them. Not everyone likes that, you know, performance first aspect of this side of crawling. So always interested to hear what you guys are thinking, especially on something that's a little bit more outside of the box. As always, I appreciate you guys watching. Thanks again for joining me. Hit the like button if you enjoy these videos, subscribe if you're not already, and hit the notification bell so you see the videos as soon as they get uploaded. Thanks again, and we'll see you on the next one.